Let Brother Ben do those baptisms. But just a few things in the way of announcements this morning. There's not a lot to cover. If you have a bulletin, you can follow along as well. We're going to have a Christmas program this year. Going to have music. If you are interested in singing, all right, so if you're interested in playing, not playing a part, but singing a part or participating in any way, then you talk to Brother Greg, and he can give you kind of more direction on kind of what we're expecting or what we're interested in doing this year. But if you're a singer and you want to play a part in the Christmas program this year, just let Brother Greg know. Also, October 16th through November 20th, those are the dates, a little over a month there, month window, where you can bring your shoe boxes for Operation Christmas Child. Empty boxes and supplies are in the foyer, so grab you some boxes and turn those in if you can within October 16th and November 20th. October 23rd is our homecoming, so we'll have at 10 a.m. we'll have a singing, and then at 11 a.m. We'll have actual service, and then we'll have a fellowship meal to follow afterwards. But that is literally all I have in the way of announcements. So at this time, I'm going to sit down and hand it over to Brother Greg, or Brother Ben, sorry.
All right, tonight, first of all, this morning we've got Miss Hallie, Elliot, and we're thankful for Miss Hallie. God's been working in her life, and she was saved a few weeks ago at children's camp. Miss Hallie, you asked the Lord to come in your heart and to save you there, and she's come and came down a few weeks ago to let everybody know she'd been saved and wanted to be baptized and become part of our church. We're proud of her, thankful for all her family that's here with her. So I'm going to pray, and you pray as I pray, and pray the Lord will bless Miss Hallie. Father, we're thankful for Hallie today and thankful there at children's camp. She put her faith and trust in the Lord, and we pray you bless her, Lord, as she now follows you in baptism. And so thankful for our family, and just pray you be with all of them. And we thank you for your goodness in our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, in obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith, and under the authority of Farmington Baptist Church, I baptize thee, Hallie Elliott, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.
All right, now we got Miss Lydia here sitting. Miss Lydia was saved several months ago and came down last Sunday and wanted to let everybody know that she'd been saved and also become part of our church, follow the Lord in baptism. We're thankful for her. Her brother's going to be baptized after this, and so appreciate our family, all of them that's here to watch her this morning. I'm going to pray, and you pray as I pray, and pray for the Lord to bless Miss Lydia. Father, we're thankful for Lydia today, and we pray you'd bless her. So thankful that several months ago she looked to Jesus and asked the Lord to forgive her of her sins and come into our life. And just pray you'd bless her now. Be with all of her family, Lord, and be with her as she's baptized. And we pray she'd always put you first and live for you and serve you. We ask you to bless her. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith, and under the authority of Farmington Baptist Church, I baptize thee, Lydia Hearson, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.
Now we got Bryson, and we appreciate Bryson Hearson, Lydia's older brother, and he was saved last year, and got to talk with him, and he knew that he was saved, and now he's come and wants to, now he's been saved, it's believer's baptism, get saved, then you follow the Lord in baptism, and he wants everybody to know that he's been saved, and follow the Lord in that example, and become a member of our church. Let's pray, and I'm going to pray for Bryson as you pray as well. Father, we're so thankful for Bryson, and thankful that last year he looked to Jesus and asked the Lord to save him and forgive him of his sins. And Lord, I pray you'd bless him as he's baptized now and wants to become part of our church family. And we're so appreciative, so thankful for his family, and pray you'd bless all of them. Pray you'd bless Bryson in the years ahead, that he'd always follow Jesus and make the Lord number one in his life. But Lord, you bless him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, in obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith, and under the authority of Farmington Baptist Church, I baptize thee, Bryson Hearson, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said,
Amen.
You did great, ready? All right, we're thankful God's been working in the life of our church. So proud of all these who were baptized last Sunday and this Sunday, and I know you'll be praying for them, that God will continue to bless their lives. Brother Greg, you and the praise team, come and lead us, if you will, this morning, brother.
We've had a good service already this morning, and we want you to join us in singing and worshiping the Lord through song. So if you would, stand up. Glad you could be here at Farmington Baptist Church. Glad to have some visitors with us. Make sure you make the visitors feel welcome. All right, let's start out with Send the Light.
There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless waves. Send the light, send the light. There are souls to rescue, there are souls to save. Send the light, send the light, send the light. The blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. We have heard the Macedonian call today. Send the light, send the light. And a golden offering at the cross we lay. Send the light, send the light, send the light. The blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. Send the light, send the light. Let us gather jewels for a crown above. Send the light, send the light, send the light. The blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore.
Amen. Thanks for helping us sing. And for those, I know we have a lot of people out of town with it being fall break for students and some of the teachers coming up. But for those who are joining us on Facebook Live, we appreciate it. Let's continue on with a song called When the Morning Comes.
Trials dark on every hand, and we cannot understand all the ways that God would lead us to that blessed promised land. But He'll guide us with His eye, and we'll follow till we die. We will understand it better by and by. By and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God are gathered home. We will tell the story how we've overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Oft our cherished plans have failed, disappointments have prevailed, and we've wandered in the darkness, heavy-hearted and alone. But we're trusting in the Lord, and according to His Word, we will understand it better by and by. By and by, when the morning comes, God are gathered home. We will tell the story how we've overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Temptation's hidden snares often take us unawares, and our hearts are made to bleed for some thoughtless word or deed. And we wonder why the test when we try to do our best, but we'll understand it better by and by. By and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God are gathered home, we will tell the story how we've overcome. We will understand it better by and by.
Amen. We'll understand it better by and by. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Brother Dale Smith, would you lead us, please? Amen. All right, let's continue on with the Lord. I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. From heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high.
Amen. Well, Miss Shara is going to bring the special for us here in just a moment, but let's finish up with our morning song worship service with 10,000 Reasons.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Your rich in love and your you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. On that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, soul, oh my soul, and worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. I will worship Your holy name, Lord, I'll worship Your holy name.
Amen. You can be seated.
All right, Miss Cheryl, we appreciate that. That's a wonderful song, and you do a great job with it. Appreciate singing the special this morning. We're going to be in the book of 1 Samuel chapter number 3. There in the Old Testament, 1 Samuel chapter number 3 and verse 1. Want us to think about this thought today. Is God speaking to you? Is God speaking to you? 1 Samuel chapter number 3. We're going to look at the first few verses, but let's read verse number 1 this morning as we think about young Samuel. 1 Samuel, there in the Old Testament, chapter number 3. You can put your ribbon here as we'll stay right here. 1 Samuel chapter 3 and verse 1 is God speaking to you. The Bible says there in 1 Samuel 3 and verse 1, "And the child Samuel ministered unto the Lord before Eli, and the word of the Lord was precious in those days. There was no open vision." Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer this morning. Father, thank you for the good day, Lord, the worship and the all of the music, Lord, the fellowship and the Sunday school hour. We're so thankful for those we had to baptize again this Sunday, and we pray you'd bless them. And thank you for their families who are here with them this morning. And we pray now as we look to the Word of God, Father, may the Word of God be that lamp unto our feet and light unto our path. May it speak to each and every heart this morning. Father, forgive us of our sins. May Jesus be lifted up. In His name we pray. Amen. All right, here in 1 Samuel 3, we've got a wonderful story about the prophet Samuel when he's just a young person. The Bible calls him the child Samuel. And I want us to look here and think about that and look at this story and make the application to how God speaks to you and I today. God speaks to us. And so let's look here, and I want you to see, if you're taking notes, I'll give you three R's. I want you to see, number one, the range of ages. When God speaks to people, God speaks to people when they're young. God speaks to people when they're old. The range of ages. I want to show you from the Bible how God speaks to us at different times in our life. I want you to see, number two, the resources God uses to speak to our lives. Brother Ben, all right, if you're telling me God is speaking to me, how does God get my attention? How does God speak to us today? He speaks in a lot of different ways. Sometimes He uses people. Sometimes He uses circumstances and events. And mainly He uses two things that He speaks to us today. We'll talk about them for a moment. So I want you to see, number one, the range of ages God speaks to us, the resources God uses to speak to us, and number three, I want you to see your response when God is speaking to you. What will your response be when God is speaking to you? Let's think about those three things this morning. The range of ages. You ought to underline that third word in verse 1. "And the child Samuel ministered unto the Lord." Samuel's there at the tabernacle, serving as a young person there, helping out, serving and helping the high priest Eli. But notice the Bible calls him the child Samuel. How old was Samuel at this time? We don't know. That word child is the Hebrew word Nahor. 76 times in the Bible it's translated young man. 44 it's translated child. And 33 times it's translated lad. He was probably a young person. Josephus, the historian, he thought he was probably around 11 years old. I thought it's interesting. It's the very same Hebrew word. You may remember when David wanted to go fight Goliath. And David goes up there and he meets King Saul. And Saul says, "You cannot do this. David, you can't go fight that man. He's a champion. He's a man of war." And Saul looks at David and says, "You're but a youth." Very same word. It's sometimes translated lad, a child, a young man, a youth. Somewhere he's somewhere around the age of 11 or 12, maybe a couple of years older, maybe a couple of years younger, when God begins to speak to young Samuel. And here's why I thought that was interesting. God speaks to us at different ages. God can speak to young people. God can speak to us when we're a child. We've baptized several people this day and last Sunday that were younger. God speaks to us sometimes when we're young. Matter of fact, Jesus Himself said, "Unless you become as a little child, you'll never enter the kingdom of God." You've got to have that childlike
faith. You've got to come to that point where, listen, I don't care what the liberals say. I don't care what the critics say. I don't care what the atheists, the agnostics say. I believe that Jesus lived and He died. I believe He rose from the dead. I believe He's the Son of God, and I want Him to be my Savior. You've got to have that childlike faith. Children can be saved when they come to that age where they're able to understand the gospel, to understand that they've sinned, but Jesus is the Savior, and come to that point where God begins to speak to their heart. That's different ages for all of us. You know, we're all, God doesn't use a cookie cutter mold when He makes us. We're all different. One preacher friend of mine says, you know, different is good. We're all, not, none of us, we're not all the same. You know, I can remember growing up in church, and when I was a boy, it was a little different. You know, we didn't have children's church, and you sit there in the pew, and if you acted up, I mean, right there in the middle of the service, Brother Gary, Dad would jerk us up, me or Jay. The preacher never miss a lick. Jerk us up, go right out the front door, out there on the porch, and you get a whooping right there during the service. I mean, you were made to sit and listen. I remember one time, and I'm telling you, this really happened now. There was none of that. You didn't get up to go to the bathroom. I mean, you just sit and listen. But I remember one time, this one boy, his Holloway boy, he was a couple years younger than me, and he was acting up, and his dad jerked him up. The preacher's up there preaching, headed out the front door, and he hollers out. Everybody heard him. He said, "Y'all pray for me." Busted up. The preacher had to reboot that time. But you know, I was made to sit there and listen. And we had good preachers, but we're all different. I don't remember as a 7-year-old, as an 8-year-old, 9, or even 10, God speaking to my heart. God can speak to people of that age. We're all different. I don't remember when I was 9 or 10, God speaking to my heart, but I remember when I was 11, when it came, that conviction, that tug, that pull of the Holy Spirit, God speaking to my heart. It started when I was 11, and it came like a whirlwind. God speaks to us at different ages. If you're a young person and God is speaking to you today, man, run to Christ. You may say, "Well, preacher, God didn't speak to me when I was young, or maybe I didn't grow up in church, or, you know, I said no to God when I was a young person." But here's a good thing. God speaks to us when we're adults, doesn't He? Zacchaeus, how old was Zacchaeus when he got saved? How old was the thief on the cross when he got saved? How old was the woman at the well? How old was Saul on the road to Damascus? I'm going to tell you, God speaks to us when we're young. God speaks to us when we're adults. If you're an adult today, God can save you. God can change your life. God speaks to us at different ages. You may say, "Well, preacher, I've lived my whole life, and I've said no to Jesus time and time again, and I'm an older man, I'm an older person, I'm a senior adult." But here's a good thing. You can get saved at that age. There in the Old Testament, and you can read this and look at it later, in 2 Chronicles 33, there was a man by the name of Manasseh, a wicked king. He was an ungodly man. He's the man that killed the prophet Isaiah. You've read the book of Isaiah in the Bible. Manasseh had Isaiah put to death. Manasseh was an ungodly man. But the Bible tells us in 2 Chronicles 33 and verse 12, at the end of his life, he cried out to God and asked God to save him. The Bible said he humbled himself before the Lord and he besought the Lord his God. And as an older man, Manasseh got saved. You can get saved at any age. The thing is, the Bible says today's the day of salvation. But don't get me wrong. You may say, "Well, preacher, that's good. I'll wait till I'm on my deathbed." You may not have that opportunity. "I'll wait till next year. I don't know what next year is going to bring. I'll wait till I'm older." The Bible says our life is like a vapor. It's here for a moment and then it's gone. That's why the Bible says today. I don't know about tomorrow. I don't know about next year. But we've got right now. Today is the day to be saved. If God is dealing with you, cry out to Jesus now and be saved. Everybody, God speaks at different ages. He speaks to young people. He speaks to adults. He speaks to senior adults. Whatever stage of life you're in, God speaks to us. God loves us. Jesus can save us. So we notice the range of ages. I would underline that word in your Bible. The child Samuel. God spoke to Samuel as a child, as a young person. No matter what age you are, God can make a difference. God speaks to us. Well, Brother Ben, how does God speak to us today? What are the resources God uses to speak to us? Well, you notice the last part of verse 1, 1 Samuel 3, it says, "And in the word of the Lord was precious in those days. There was no open vision. Now, the Old Testament's a little different than the New Testament. That's why we've got two parts of the Bible, the Old Testament and the New Testament. In the Old Testament, there was a temple. In the New Testament, we've got a church. In the Old Testament, there was a nation of Israel. Today, we've got Christians, God's people. There's some differences. In the Old Testament, they had sacrifices. In the New Testament, Jesus is our once-for-all sacrifice on the cross. In the Old Testament, God spoke sometimes with an audible voice. Sometimes God would speak through visions. God spoke through the Word of God. They had the Pentateuch, Genesis and Exodus. You know, they had the books of the Bible before this in the Bible. Genesis through the book of Judges at this time. God spoke through the Word. He spoke through His voice. He spoke through visions. Today, God speaks in a lot of ways. Sometimes something will happen in your life and God's trying to get your attention. Things don't happen by accident. God's a big God. There's no such thing as chance with God. Sometimes God uses people. He places people in our lives to help us along the way to speak to us. But most of the time, God speaks through the Word and the Spirit. You remember in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16, the Bible says, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, correction, for instruction in righteousness. God speaks through the Word of God. There's something about the Bible. If I was standing up here and talking about Shakespeare, most of you'd get up and leave. If I was talking about history, we'd get up, you'd say, maybe that interests me or maybe it doesn't. But there's something about the Bible. I've told you many times, that's why you look at the Bible, it says Holy Bible on it. The word Bible is from the Greek word biblos, book, but it's got the word holy in front of it to show you this book is different than any other book that's ever been written. This book will speak to your heart. The Bible says it's like a fire inside of our bones. It's like a sword that's a double-edged sword. It's like a hammer that breaks the rock into pieces. God's Word will speak to you. When the Word of God is preached, it will get a hold of your life. God speaks to us when the Word of God goes out. God speaks through the Holy Spirit. The Bible says in John 16, in verse number 13, when He, the Spirit of truth, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth has come, He will guide you into all truth. God speaks to us through the Word. And you ever felt that sense where you can just feel the Lord's convicting you? The Lord is dealing with you about something. It's like the Lord is speaking. The Bible says He does it in a still, small voice. When God wants to speak to you, He speaks through the Word. He speaks through the Holy Spirit. God's not going to write it in the sky. God's not going to knock you down with a bolt of lightning. God's going to speak to you through the Word and the Spirit. And they go out and they get a hold of us. There's power in the Word of God. There's power in the Holy Spirit. He speaks through those things. That's how we hear about Jesus. The Bible says that faith cometh by hearing, and hearing the Word of God. You think about if you're a Christian today, when you got saved, you knew about Jesus. Maybe mama or daddy told you about Jesus. Maybe it was a Sunday school teacher. Maybe it was somebody in Bible school. Maybe it was a grandparent. Maybe it was during a revival meeting. Maybe it was by watching a Billy Graham special on TV or reading the Bible or reading a gospel tract. But somebody told you about Jesus. You heard the gospel and you believed the gospel. That's why the Word of God, it's powerful. The resources, God speaks to us through those things. That's why we share the Word of God with people. That's why we tell people about Jesus. There's power in the Word and the Spirit. God speaks to us at all different ages. If you're young, God can speak to you. If you're older, God can speak to you. God speaks in a lot of ways. Providence, events that happen, people in our lives, but mainly through the Word and the Spirit. But here's the real question. How will you respond when God speaks to you? When God speaks to you through the Word, when God speaks to you through the Spirit, are you going to say yes to Jesus? Or are you going to say no? When you read the story, and we don't have time to read all these verses, God speaks to Samuel. And Samuel is confused. He's not sure what's going on. And then finally, you notice in verse number 10 of 1 Samuel chapter 3, and the Lord came, and the Lord stood and called as at the other times, Samuel, Samuel. Then Samuel answered, he responded. I'd underline that word answered. Then Samuel answered, "Speak, for thy servant heareth." When God speaks to us, what kind of response will you have? God speaks. Nobody else can respond for you. You read the story, Eli couldn't respond for Samuel. Sometimes we wish we could respond for other people. Preacher, I wish my spouse would get saved, but you can't trust Jesus for them. Brother Ben, I wish my parents would get, you can't do it for them. I wish my kids are, it's 101. You've heard it said before, God has no grandchildren. It's 101. You've got to receive Jesus. You've got to accept Jesus. Nobody else can do it for you. Samuel's there and he cries out and he says, "Lord, speak." He says yes to Jesus. God speaks and he gets a hold of us. How do you know that? Well, you read the examples. For example, in the book of Acts, on the day of Pentecost, Peter stands up and he preaches and the word of God goes forth and the Bible says they were pricked in their hearts. It was like somebody was sticking them with a knife in their heart. God speaks to us and we feel it. It's a still, small voice. It's small. It's there. It's constant. God is speaking to us. It's like he's pricking us in the very heart of our soul. What will you do? Will you say yes to Jesus? Will you say no to Jesus? Sometimes we'll say, well, wait. But that's really just another way of saying no. You know, God calls repeatedly. And you see in this story, God kept calling. He calls Samuel three different times in this story. And God calls us many times. When I was 11 years old and God began to call me and God began to speak to my heart about being saved, I kept saying no to Jesus. You know, that we'd have the invitation and God would be dealing with me and I'd look down, I'd hold the pew, I wouldn't dare make eye contact with the pastor and, you know, I didn't want to talk to anybody about it. I'd say no, no, no. God kept calling. God kept calling. God kept coming back. And sometimes we'll say, well, preacher, God keeps on coming to speaking to me. God keeps coming back. I'll just do it later. But the Bible gives us a verse in the book of Genesis where God says, "My spirit will not always strive with men." God hasn't promised to call upon you forever. God hasn't promised to speak to you forever. He calls, and often He keeps calling. But again, that's why we say today. Today's the day of salvation. There's a great preacher years ago, back in the 1800s, and he was like the Billy Graham of his day. His books are still published. His sermons are still read. About once a month, I'll put a quote from him in the bulletin, and he pastored this large church up in Chicago, D.L. Moody. Just a fascinating, just a common, ordinary fella who believed in the power of the Lord and preached the Word of God, and God just saved thousands of people. And D.L. Moody was having a revival service one week up there in Chicago, and this man came and listened, and he was there. He was a Christian by the name of Will Thompson. And Thompson listened, and he watched as Moody preached the gospel, and he told people, "Will you respond? God is speaking to you. God is calling upon you. Say yes to Jesus." And he watched as the Spirit began to convict people, and many said yes to Jesus. Many got saved that day. And Will Thompson, he went home, and he wrote a little poem. He wrote a little song and he published it. He went to see Moody several years later. Moody was dying. And they weren't letting hardly anybody in to see D.L. Moody, but Thompson was there and D.L. Moody says, "I want to see that man before he dies, before I die." And D.L. Moody's on his deathbed and he grabs Will Thompson. He says, "I'm so thankful you wrote this song. We sing it all the time in my services. I'm so thankful, I'm so proud for you writing this song." And you know the song. We sing it all the time. The words of the song are, "Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. See on the portals, He's waiting and watching. Watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. You who are weary, come home. Earnestly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling, O sinner, come home." How many people have been converted, been saved, as that song was being sung? God speaks. God calls. God deals with us, whatever terminology you want to use. The question is, will you respond? Some of you that are here, and I don't know who's here, but some of you are here, you've never been saved. Maybe you're young, maybe you're adult, maybe you're a senior adult, and you've sensed that still small voice. God is speaking to you. Will you say yes to Jesus? How's a person get saved? Baptism doesn't save anybody. Taking the Lord's Supper doesn't save anybody. Joining the church doesn't. That's not how we get saved. We get saved by saying yes to Jesus. Jesus, I want to be saved. Jesus, I'm asking you to save me. Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner, and I know you're the Savior. And Lord, I'm trusting you today. We cry out to Jesus, and we get saved. Some of you are here, and you've been saved. You say, preacher, I remember when that happened to me. God called, God spoke to me, God was dealing with me, and I got saved. God keeps on dealing with us. God keeps on speaking to us. God speaks to us about living for Him. God speaks to us about being faithful. God speaks to us about getting in the church and serving the Lord. God, just because you're saved, don't think, well, preacher, I know that I'm a Christian. I know if I was to die right now, I'd go to heaven. But God still speaks. He speaks through the Word and the Spirit. God is speaking to some of you about living for Jesus. Some of you about getting in the church. Some of you about getting in the church more faithful. He's speaking to you about living for Him, about doing something for Him, maybe about serving Him in some way. God speaks. Christian, you say yes to Jesus. Lord, I'm listening. I want to do what you want me to do. But especially, I'm going to pray in just a moment, but if you're not a Christian, if you've never been saved, and you felt the Holy Spirit tugging at your heart, that still small voice you've been pricked in your heart, you say yes to Jesus. You cry out to Him. You can be saved today. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the story of Samuel. How you called upon him, you spoke to him, and Lord, you made a difference in his life. And Lord, that teaches us that God can still change lives today. God still speaks today.